This is Story Recapped. Today, I'm going to explain an action, adventure, sci-fi film called The Tomorrow War. 30 years into the future, the sudden appearance of an alien race called White Spikes has brought humanity to the brink of extinction. To save itself, the future now calls on the past to help them fight the alien threat. Spoilers ahead. Watch out, and take care. Time travel has always been a captivating concept ever since it was first theorized. But science fiction has never failed to remind us of the risks of tampering with time. Changing something small from the past can have a drastic impact on the future. But would changing something in the future affect the past? In this film, humanity will realize that sometimes the key to saving the present lies in the future. On Christmas Eve, year 2022, Dan Forrester is talking on his phone as he drives home. He details his extensive military record, education at Cal State, and employment as a high school biology teacher, trying to convince the person on the other line to hire him. He enters his house, looking for his daughter, Muri. Dan's wife, Emmy, calls him to help out with the guests, and Dan tells her he's on the phone. Dan explains that working at a laboratory is his lifelong dream, and he thinks he has a genuine shot at achieving it. Emmy agrees, but makes him promise he'd watch TV with Muri later. Dan agrees, and excuses himself to continue his phone call. When Dan gets outside, he's met with sad news, and gets rejected. Dan then throws his paperwork into the trash in frustration. He then hits a mailbox, and knocks over a garbage bin before heading back inside. Right off the bat, we can say that Dan has an exceptional track record career-wise. He led a squadron of soldiers during his time with the armed forces, and even went on several tours. He's also found a passion for science, as he pursued a degree from Cal State. That, and his current employment as a teacher, shows that Dan is intelligent, disciplined, and committed. He's also a family man, who thinks the world of his daughter. However, his outburst also suggests Dan is extremely emotional, and has impulsive tendencies. Inside, Dan sits next to Muri, who's watching a football game. He tries his best to hide his frustration, and instead, speaks to her about her future. Dan advises Muri to be the best that she can be, telling her to do what nobody else is willing to do. Everybody then tunes into the football game, but smoke suddenly appears on the playing field. Bright lights and electricity come out of the smoke, and people begin appearing. The spectating crowd begins panicking, and a woman steps out of the smoke with an announcement. She tells them that she, and everybody who had appeared, come from 28 years into the future, the year 2051, where an alien species, called White Spikes, has invaded and killed most of humanity. She then asks for help, requesting aid to fight in the war against the White Spikes. Several months pass, and humanity in 2022 mobilizes militaries all over the world to send soldiers into 2051. Unfortunately, this was met with overwhelming loss, and only a quarter returned. To make matters worse, only half of all military personnel are qualified to make the jump into the future. Nations eventually agree to initiate a worldwide draft, inducting civilians into the war effort. With less than 20% of people returning from the future, many are protesting the war, arguing people from 2021 shouldn't be sent to fight a war that hasn't happened yet. With depleting resources, and a seemingly hopeless fight, abandoning the war is now becoming a considerable decision. Governments wasted no effort in sending valuable military resources into the war effort. Even with great loss, they continued the ineffective strategy. Civilians were even placed into the line of danger, but governments don't appear to be considering an alternative. It's not explained whether or not vehicles or other large machinery can travel into the future, but it appears that only individual infantry is getting sent in. From an outside looking in perspective, the decision seems moot. Dan is at work, teaching his biology class, but notices nobody is paying attention. He tries to change things up, asking the class what they want to talk about, but only Martin raises his hand, wanting to talk about volcanoes. Another kid asks what the point of schooling is when they all know what's going to happen in the future. Another student says people are getting sent into the future every week with almost no impact on the result. Dan counters, saying one thing the world needs now, more than ever, are scientists, and that's why he still teaches biology. Dan then gets a message, informing him he's been drafted. He then heads to a facility where military personnel from the future assess his status. They strap Dan to a chair, and put his arm into a machine, telling him it's a test. A soldier informs him that he meets the requirements for conscription. Since he can't travel to a future where he's still alive, meeting all the requirements means he's already dead by 2051. He gets confirmation when the woman tells him he's going to die in 2030. Still unable to process the information, the procedure continues with Dan barely able to comprehend what he had been told. The machine then whirs, and Dan feels excruciating pain in his arm. When he removes his arm, a metal device is attached. He's told the device keeps track of his tour in the future, and after 7 days, the device would automatically send him back to his timeline. Even the students in Dan's class are coming to realize that the war is useless. The strategy they're doing, that is, sending as many people as they can, is ineffective. Dan tries to keep their spirits up, but once he saw his name appear on the draft list, it's arguable if he still feels the same. When he went into the facility to have his assessment, the military personnel who examined him seemed too standoffish for a group of people who came to the past, essentially begging for help. They're being cryptic and borderline deceitful when they placed the ban on Dan's arm after telling him they were only running tests. They also didn't tell him how he'd die, but they told him the exact time of his death. Why they did this is still unclear, but what's clear is a lack of trust and transparency between the parties. Later, Dan meets Emmy, and she's terrified to learn about his draft and immediately suggests hiding from the government. She tells Dan that maybe his father, James, can help. Dan refuses, saying he doesn't want to have anything to do with his father, but Emmy convinces him, saying it's for their family's survival. Dan then drives to an airfield where his father works. James and Dan are noticeably cold towards one another, but James agrees to take a look at Dan's device. James then says he finds Dan's unexpected visit strange, as Dan has never needed his help. Dan is infuriated, saying all he's ever wanted since he was little was for his father to return and help him and his mom. James argues that he only left because he was in an extremely dark place when he returned from a war, and it would have been more damaging for their family if he stayed. Dan doesn't believe James, saying James was being selfish when he left. He then takes his arm away and tells James he'd never be forgiven. Dan gets home, and Emmy sees the device is still on him. Dan tries to comfort her, saying he'll only be on tour for 7 days. He then heads to the backyard where Murray is digging a hole. He tells her he needs to leave for a trip, but Murray realizes that Dan has been drafted. Murray is disheartened, but Dan promises to return. Like Dan, James also appears extremely intelligent, working as an airplane mechanic. Unfortunately, the relationship between the two is problematic, rooted in James unable to find himself after returning from the Vietnam War. James, leaving at Dan's young age, left an impact that could explain why he's reluctant to leave, as he wouldn't want to leave Murray. But with Dan leaving for war, he might also be afraid that he'd end up like his father, hence, his disinterest in joining. Dan arrives at a training facility with hundreds of other draftees. The civilians with him don't appear to even have the most basic military training. Lieutenant Hart tells them that they won't be doing any physical training and will focus on basic survival. They undergo a little gun training, but appear to skip tactical training or even team play. Dan meets a draftee named Charlie, who's the head of research and development at a geothermal energy company. Also, with the draftees, is Dorian, a cold, calculating fighter who's back for his third tour. At a briefing, they've informed how the time link works. The time link works similar to two rafts on a moving river. If time is the river, then the two rafts are 2022 and 2051. They can only move from two points, but time will always be moving forward. For this reason, they can't send people before the war begins. The time jump machine is still rudimentary and highly experimental, so they can't risk experimenting too much. One draftee asks why they haven't seen a picture of the aliens, and Lieutenant Hart answers that they don't want to scare the draftees. Later, Charlie and Dan talk in their barracks when the alarm blares. They have to jump as soon as possible. Dan says that they haven't been briefed about their assignment, but Hart tells them that they'll be briefed once they arrive. They're then all prepped to be sent into the future, and a hangar lights up with electricity. They all slowly get lifted and disintegrate. In the control room, something had gone wrong with the coordinates. So far, the military from 2051 had been extremely secretive. They refuse to give information about the white spikes, they don't give the conscripts adequate training, and they don't even give draftees intel about the mission. This could explain why the war effort had been so ineffective in battling the white spikes. The people battling them are being set up to fail. Something to note is that only people are getting sent into the future, not bombs, aircraft, tanks, or other potentially more effective means of battling the aliens. At most, these conscripts should undergo even the most basic military training, or even just how to effectively function as a unit, but instead, they're given basic survival training. One thing to note is that they're incapable of sending draftees to just before the war started due to the crude nature of the time jump machine, but 2022 is decades before the first white spikes even started appearing. If the military from 2051 instead sent troops and equipment to 2022 to prepare for the war, the outcome could be vastly different. It seems like sending large numbers of troops to an already losing war is a huge waste of time and resources. One could argue that fortifying and strengthening a pre-war past could be a better decision. How the time link works is also a point to consider. If the war finally comes for the people of 2022, they'd have severely fewer fighters and would essentially be crippled when the aliens finally attack in their timeline. Dan rematerializes, finding himself falling several hundred feet. He watches in horror as his fellow draftees fall to their deaths. Luckily, Dan falls into a swimming pool on top of a building. When he emerges, only a fraction of the draftees had survived the jump. As they regroup on the building, they see Miami in ruins. At the 2051 command post, the army colonel is spitting orders as they try to figure out what had gone wrong with the jump. They establish a radio link, and Dan responds. The colonel informs them that bombers are coming to carpet bomb the city, as it has been overrun by white spikes, but a research team is trapped at a laboratory. They're tasked to retrieve the research team, and Dan takes charge, putting his military experience to use. They make their way down a street, and Dorian tells Dan it's no use trying to make soldiers out of civilians, as it would only end with all of them getting eaten. They enter the research facility and find the research team dead. The colonel then tasks them to retrieve some vials from the laboratory, telling them to hurry, as the white spikes may be returning soon. Dan gets to the vials and retrieves them, while the rest of the team meets up at the rendezvous point. Meanwhile, jet fighters are preparing to start the bombing run. The colonel tells them to hurry, as the bombs will arrive in 6 minutes, and she can't do anything to stop it. The army seems to be in complete disarray, even with the high command. The colonel doesn't seem to be calling the shots, as she can't delay the bombing. It's not clearly stated why the bombings shouldn't be delayed until after Dan and the draftees have successfully retrieved the vials from the lab. If the research team were still alive, they would have less time evacuating and would be in the bomber's way. The city is already overrun, and there doesn't seem to be any immediate threat from the White Spikes, but the bombing is still commencing, even though there are still civilians and troops on the ground. The team then starts making their way down a stairwell when one of them hears a faint clicking coming from the upper level. They shine their flashlights, exposing a tentacle moving, and when they follow it, a White Spike is revealed, feeding on a disembodied arm. They begin firing, but bullets don't seem to do any damage, as the White Spikes have thick armored skin. The group takes casualties as they make their way down the stairs. They finally make it to a hallway, and Dan tries to buy the group some time by holding back a White Spike. He runs out of bullets and uses an axe to impale the creature's head. Luckily, Dorian returns and kills the White Spike, telling Dan to aim for their necks and bellies. The team makes it to the streets, where a military convoy comes to their rescue, but White Spikes get to the convoy first. The team continues running, this time trying to stay out of the bombing. They face more White Spikes, which are now launching projectiles from their tentacles. As Dan and the team fight, the planes begin bombing the White Spikes. They eventually make it on top of a tunnel, but one of them falls, and Dan stops to help. As a result, another person gets impaled by White Spike projectiles, and the team is left with no choice but to leave them. The two members who have fallen maintain a constant barrage of gunfire against the White Spikes, and the rest make a run for it. As they exit the tunnel, more bombs fall. Several hours later, Dan awakens in a military base with Charlie. They meet with Dorian and find out that they're the only ones who survived. Dan has an uncompromising attitude towards helping and saving his teammates. Dorian, on the other hand, focuses more on sheer survival. Dan is noble for exemplifying such behavior, but Dan could be forgetting that he's teamed with untrained and inexperienced civilians. His attempt to save the fallen member led to more men dying. Dorian has more experience battling the White Spikes, and probably concluded that the best way to survive is to leave whoever falls. Dan would probably disagree, as the whole point of joining the war is to help save people. Dan, Dorian, and Charlie talk, and Dorian says nothing they do in the future matters, as it's all for nothing. Dan then asks him why he keeps coming back, pointing to the White Spike claw around Dorian's neck, and Dorian says he found out he'll be dying in 6 months of cancer. Dan later meets with the colonel overseeing operations and discovers she's also surnamed Forrester. Dan asks where her ancestors are from, curious to know if they're related, and the colonel says they have the same ancestors. Dan takes a careful look and realizes the colonel is his daughter, Murray. Dan can't help but smile and feel a sense of pride upon seeing his daughter, not only grown up, but overseeing the entire operation. Dan gestures for a hug, but Murray steps back. Dan is taken aback, and Murray asks him to take a walk with her. Murray reveals that she also has a PhD in biotechnology, and she founded and maintains the military's research into the White Spikes. She then gets frank and tells Dan that she didn't ask to talk to him because she's sentimental. She says humans are almost gone, down to just 500,000 people. She then tells him he had been brought to the future for an important reason, but she doesn't reveal it. Murray is noticeably cold towards her father. According to the recruiters, Dan died in 2030 in their timeline. That would place the future Murray at 16 years old at that time of Dan's death. It may be because she's surviving in a bleak world, but it may also be because she's had a falling out with Dan. She doesn't kiss him or hug him, not even a simple handshake. Murray maintains the secrecy of the 2051 Army personnel when she told Dan he's there for an important purpose, but she refused to tell more details. Murray then shows Dan footage of a female White Spike. The females appear to be the most important members of the White Spike Hive, as they ensure successful reproduction. Dan is then placed on an assignment to capture a female White Spike. Murray had been developing a toxin that kills the White Spikes, but appears to be ineffective against females. To develop a more potent toxin, they have to capture a female. Murray accompanies the mission, and they set out to a White Spike nest. Murray narrates how the White Spikes appeared out of nowhere. They managed to avoid satellite imagery and radar, and started laying waste to Russia. It only took them 3 years to conquer the rest of the world. Dan then tells Murray he found out that he'd die in 7 years, and asks Murray what happened to their family. Murray tells him it'd be better if he doesn't know. Moments later, they arrive at the nest. In the nest, the female is decimating soldiers. Murray and several men descend to help, but they prove ineffective. The female manages to kill more men, but Murray gets a clean shot at its neck. The female then begins calling the males. Dan sees the males approaching and jumps into the nest to help Murray. Murray and Dan then manage to push the female into a cage. Helicopters lift the female, but they're quickly overrun. It appears that the future military is in the process of developing a toxin that could potentially wipe out all the White Spikes. This seems to be a much better idea than bringing in troops from the past. Surprisingly, developing the toxin doesn't appear to be the military's top priority, and is only something Murray and her team are developing. Maybe the military thinks that this is a lost cause and doesn't want to funnel the already depleting resources into it. Maury doesn't want to speak about her family. This could be a clue as to why she's been cold to Dan. Dan and Maury manage to get into a Humvee and escape. Maury gets angry because Dan put himself in harm's way when he tried to help, but Dan reasons that he's not going to let his daughter die. In her anger, Maury reveals what happened to Dan and their family. She narrates how Dan had left their family. When Maury was a teenager, Emmy and Dan got a divorce. Dan is in complete disbelief. He knows he'd never leave Emmy or Maury. On Maury's 16th birthday, she got a call that Dan had been in a car accident. She got to the hospital and held him in her arms as he died. As Maury sobs, Dan is left speechless. They're later brought to a floating military base surrounded by mines and dozens of ships. This facility houses the time jump machine and appears to be humanity's last remaining stronghold. Maury's revelation seems like an extremely unlikely occurrence. Dan upheld his family over everything, as he knows firsthand how it feels to be left alone through James. There's a possibility that the Dan in her timeline could be a different Dan. They are potentially not from the same continuity at all. Something to remember is that the military in 2022 is already heavily crippled. They already have a 30-year head start over the White Spikes, something the 2051 world didn't have. Dan later goes to the lab with the female White Spike, where Maury is developing a toxin. Dan helps Maury with the experiments, and he asks how they'll deploy the toxin if they ever synthesize it successfully. Maury says she has a solution, but refrains from telling unless they create the toxin. Dan says he's proud of her, but Maury doesn't acknowledge it. Another day passes, and Dan asks what his purpose is, alluding to what Maury said earlier. Maury gives in and tells him that the toxin she's creating isn't meant for them to use against the White Spikes, but for Dan to bring with him to the past. Dan is in disbelief, realizing that Maury is asking him to abandon the future and prevent the war from ever happening. Dan agrees to take the toxin back, but says he'll come back for her. A computer rings, indicating that the toxin has been successfully synthesized, and they rush to get the vial. Suddenly, the female White Spike awakens and begins calling the males. Outside, an army of White Spikes descends upon the human stronghold. Dan and Maury are now in a race against time to keep the vial of toxin and Dan safe long enough for him to be transported back. Maury's plan was never to save the future or win the war, but to prevent it from happening altogether. Only if the rest of the military had the same mindset, countless numbers of civilians could have been spared. It seems that only Maury had the idea to strengthen and give better resources to the past to prepare them for a future war. This seems like the most logical thing to do, as it would give the people in 2022 a huge advantage over the White Spikes. The only thing left to do now is to ensure Dan is successful in making the jump back. White Spikes swarm the facility, and Dan and Maury cut through the engine room to get to the helipad. They find themselves surrounded, but manage to make progress, shooting and killing everything in their way. They make their way down a platform, but Maury gets impaled with a spike. Dan takes Maury, and they limp their way to a second helipad. Maury tells Dan he has to leave her, but he refuses. She sobs, and tells him she's happy to see him, as he was when she was a kid. Maury confesses that humanity was never going to win the war, and the only way to defeat the White Spikes is to kill them before they ever get the chance to multiply. The bridge collapses, and Maury falls, but Dan catches her. Maury loses her grip and falls into a pool of White Spikes. Dan dives after her, but the time link activates, and he's transported back to 2022. As he gets his bearings, he sees Hart. He tells them to take the toxin, mass-produce it, and have it sent back to the future. But Hart tells him that the time link is offline, and they can no longer travel back through time. He's surprised to see Charlie next to him, who says he survived by hiding. Dan arrives back home and sees Maury again. Dan looks disturbed at first, acting like he'd seen a ghost, but he gets on his knees and hugs the little girl. Dan had just witnessed his daughter perish at the hands of 100 White Spikes. Luckily, he didn't see what followed after Maury landed in the pile. The time link had been severed, indicating humanity in 2051 had lost completely to the White Spikes. Dan is now left with the burden to ensure the White Spikes never get a foothold on the planet and prevent the future from ever happening. Dan, getting back to his timeline and seeing Maury young again must have been surreal. Seeing his daughter young again after he'd just seen her fall to her death must be extremely relieving and terrifying at the same time. Later that night, Dan speaks to Emmy and he tells her everything. He narrates how they created a toxin and how the White Spikes seemingly appeared out of nowhere. Emmy then poses the idea that the White Spikes may have been here longer, but were undetected. Dan realizes the same thing and decides to call Dorian. Dan meets with Dorian and Charlie. Charlie takes a look at the White Spike claw. Dorian keeps and determines that the claw has volcanic ash not from Russia, but Asia. To know how this happened, they need a volcano expert, so they turn to Martin, Dan's student. Martin says the only way for ash from Asia to get into the White Spikes in Russia is for it to happen during the Millennium Eruption when a volcano in China's border erupted in 946 AD. Martin takes a computer and shows them the biggest glacier in Russia, where scientists drilled and found ash from the Millennium Eruption. Dorian asks why the White Spikes dug so deep, and Charlie and Dan realize that the aliens didn't dig down, but dug themselves up. They concluded that the white spikes had landed on Earth eons ago, but remained frozen. Martin puts up a simulated ice melt for the year 2048. It shows the glacier melting completely. They realize the white spikes had just thawed when they attacked. Knowing the government won't support their claims, the group heads to James and tells him what they intend to do. He agrees, saying they'll take an old military plane he has in the hangar. They begin loading up, and Lieutenant Hart arrives with the toxins. She says she's happy to help, as she's worked closely with Murray too. It's a little perplexing how out of everyone on the planet, it was Emmy who realized that the white spikes could have arrived earlier. Charlie luckily identifies it as his work is related to Earth science, but it's rather comedic how they had to turn to Martin for more information. It could be assumed that a geothermal energy company would have some sort of expert on volcanoes. Their plan is now built on Emmy's theory, Martin's assumption, and a whole lot of wishful thinking. Several hours later, they're in the Russian Alps. They arrive in an area that has a strange effect on their navigation devices. They then decide to blow up the ice to uncover what's underneath. They make their way into a cave and find a massive ship stuck in the ice. They enter the ship, finding themselves in the cockpit, but the alien they find doesn't resemble the white spikes. Dan realizes the aliens didn't land, but crashed. They explore further and find pods filled with white spikes. They begin injecting the pods with toxins, and the white spikes begin convulsing and melting. The rest of the white spikes begin waking up, and several manage to run away. They all split up with Dan, James, and Charlie heading out to kill the white spikes who made it out of the ship, while Dorian, Hart, and the rest of the team hunt the white spikes in the ship. Hart discovers an entire colony of white spikes awakening, and Dorian decides they have to blow the entire ship up. He laces the ship with several packs of explosives, and as Hart gets swarmed, Dorian detonates the bombs. The entire glacier erupts into flames, killing all the white spikes. It appears that the white spikes weren't an alien species that came out of nowhere, but could have been a weapon used to invade a planet. It would seem that the ship carrying them may not have been targeting Earth, but they were unfortunately released on the planet merely by complete chance. The white spikes are akin to the xenomorph species from Aliens that were only engineered as a weapon for conquering planets. Hart and Dorian understood what they had to do and sacrificed their lives to destroy the ship. Dorian died by his terms, and Hart got redemption, knowing she saved the future. Dan meets with James and Charlie, finding out a female is still alive. They decide to split up to hunt it, and James finds tracks. He baits the female and starts shooting it, but it keeps running towards him. As the female pounces, Dan comes just in time, smashing his snowmobile into the female. They then begin shooting the creature, hitting it in the neck and pushing it towards the cliff. The female disappears and comes up behind them, splitting the two. It runs to Dan, but he manages to stab it in its mouth. James comes up and gouges its eyes out. The blinded female pins Dan down, but James cuts his hand, attracting it. The female runs to James, but Dan grabs onto it at the last second, slashing its neck open. He then takes the toxin and smashes it into the creature's mouth. The female then staggers back and falls to its death. Time passes, and news of the events on the Russian glacier spread. The alien threat, as it appears for now, has been neutralized. Dan returns to his family, and he finally introduces James to Murray. As he hugs his wife and his daughter, he realizes that the future he had seen had been erased. Now, humanity has a chance to write its own tomorrow.
Subscribe to watch more videos like this. Turn on notifications. And leave a like, it really helps the channel out. Thank you for watching.